Back to today, and next on Radio 3, our music feature, in which the journalist Martin Kettle wonders, why do women die in opera?
Where would opera be without dead women? It's hard to think of another art form more umbilically dependent on female mortality. Female corpses simply litter the opera stage. Yes, of course, men die too in opera. Think of Tristan, Otello, Scarpia. And in the comedies, usually, no one dies at all. But when it comes to the most popular tragic operas, it's simply undeniable that, whether through suicide, murder, asphyxiation, drowning, execution, consumption, leaping off a balcony, dying in an avalanche, or even singing herself to death, to a disconcerting extent, it's the soprano, and occasionally the mezzo, who gets the chop.
It's like a bullfight. Someone has to die, either the torero or the bull. I would say that the woman is the bull.
I made a specialty of dying women. I died in many of my roles, and I did very few operas where I lived.
If you want to show off what your woman can do with her wonderful voice and her technique and so on, you're going to put her in extreme situations, and it's quite likely that she's going to end up dying.
The woman in opera is always seen as a sorceress or a witch and a bad animal who causes the downfall of the man.
Opera is the more the, you know, I mean, the paradise of women rather than some kind of penitentiary where women are tormented and abused by male composers. It's always the sopranos who sing the top lines, and, you know, I mean, they're the ones that we go to the opera for.
Wagner's Isolde, Violetta in Verdi's La Traviata, Bizet's Carmen are just some of the most prominent of opera's dead women. Then there's Puccini's Mimi in La Boheme. There's Tosca and Madame Butterfly, Richard Strauss's Salome and Elektra. Most opera lovers, I imagine, sit through these works without being particularly concerned at all these deaths. But to my mind, it's a question well worth asking. Why are there so many dead women in the great operas? I'm far from the first to be struck by this phenomenon. Just over 30 years ago, the French writer Catherine Clément wrote an entire book on the subject, Opera, the Undoing of Women. Dr. Margaret Reynolds teaches literature at Queen Mary University in London.
The reason why it was so tremendously important was because everybody looked at opera, and because it had become such a cultural icon, nobody could challenge it. So for Clément to come along and just say, ah, excuse me, hold on a minute, guys, there's only one thing that goes on in all of these operas, which isn't quite true, but it was a good argument, is that women get tortured and then they die. And nobody else had noticed that before. People had not dealt with the stories. People hadn't thought about what was actually being represented on stage. And she bases her critique of it on psychological methods. She doesn't necessarily go back to a historical context. But of course, once you do start to think about the historical context within which these operas were produced, then you can certainly see how her argument bears up. And that's why she's still such an important figure today.
And her importance resonates across the Atlantic. Clément's torchbearer is California-based professor of music, Susan McClary.
What I would argue is that the same thing happens in novels at the time. The same thing happens in paintings at the time. Opera is not alone in this. I would say it is a late 19th century phenomenon and not specifically an operatic phenomenon, though the way that it is played out in opera with spectacular women singing makes it perhaps more obvious to us. And because opera remains alive to us in ways that late 19th century novels don't.
The glut of diva deaths in 19th century grand opera may not amount to an outright conspiracy against women, but we shouldn't dismiss these deaths as merely incidental either. Key to understanding them is opera's reverence for the high voice, which goes right back to the birth of opera in the late 16th century. Taking its inspiration from ancient Greek theatre, this art form was conceived as a blend of words, performance, and music. Crucially, the words had to soar over the orchestra, and nothing did this so well as the high voice. By the 18th century, when opera had really begun its rise, the high voice could be that of a woman, or a boy, or of a castrato, a singer castrated before puberty to prevent his voice from breaking.
The whole question of who played what kind of role in the 18th century was very mixed and muddled up. So, for instance, you have an opera where a woman plays the role of Hercules. As long as they've got the required high voice, the 18th century do not care who's actually doing the singing, whether it's a man or a woman. But then something happens at the end of the 18th century, something radical, and that is this. During the period of the French Revolution, leading up to that period, many women in Europe and in Britain, women like Mary Wollstonecraft, women like Madame de Staël in France, were claiming new kinds of roles and challenging conventional gender representations. And men became tremendously worried about this. Napoleon, in particular, hated this gender fluidity. He didn't like the castrati on the operatic stage, but he also wanted to put women back in their place. So that's where you start to get the classic beginnings of the kinds of roles in opera where women have a high voice and that high voice is valued, but the women have to die. They have to be punished for any kind of presumption or ambition or transgression on their part whatsoever.
The death count is definitely higher in the 19th century repertoire.
Opera director David McVicar.
And I think that's got something to do with the fact that somehow in a time in Europe where women in one sense were invisible, on the operatic stage are powerfully given a voice and powerfully express, for one thing, their erotic side in a way which women in polite society that would go and watch these operas obviously could not do. But the problem with that is you can't open Pandora's box. You know, Pandora's box has to be conveniently slammed shut at the end. So I think one big strand of it is those female characters have to pay for self-expression. Otherwise it's too threatening, otherwise it's too scary. They have to be shut up.
The composer who, it could be argued, most readily killed off his women in this way was Puccini. We'll come to him in a moment. But earlier in the 19th century, it was Verdi, with his consumptive courtesan Violetta, or La Traviata, the woman gone astray, who epitomised this phenomenon. Does Violetta have to die? The French soprano, who has sung the role many times, Natalie Dessay.
Violetta has, according to me, she has to die because she can't stand the fact that she's a pure soul with a dirty life because of the look of the society on her. And the society is represented by Germont, who tells her very frankly, my dear, it's impossible. You are a whore. You are lost for us and for yourself.
Oh.
So the only way to go out with a high head is to sacrifice yourself.
But the character of Violetta is more complex than that. We have only to hear the rapturously tender but defiant final aria that Verdi gives his heroine to realise that whatever society might have made of women of her kind, the composer was in deep sympathy with her. Far from endorsing repressive social attitudes, Verdi was, in fact, contesting them.
It is so clear from that glorious music who is right and who is wrong in this story.
Director of opera at the Royal Opera House, Elaine Padmore.
And you know, when an audience is sitting there in the dark, whether they're men or women, they also know who is right and who is wrong. Yes, of course, Jean Monpère with his top hat and so on would have had many contemporaries wearing the same kind of clothes in a 19th century audience. But even men, I think, in the dark, when they see this suffering, must have known that actually Violetta was a woman with a true heart, whose emotions were the right ones. And men weren't being hypocritical. They knew they were being hypocritical.
Verdi himself had every reason to highlight society's hypocrisy towards free women. His personal life at the time of composition offers a clue to how much lay at stake for him with this opera.
One of the things biographically that's often said about Traviata is that it was, you know, a kind of defiant vindication of Giuseppina Strapponi. It's a very important soprano.
Author of A Song of Love and Death, The Meaning of Opera, Peter Conrad.
She was a woman who had a very shady past. The two lived together for a number of years, despite the disapproval of small-town society in Busseto near Parma. And despite the disapproval of his patron, eventually he married her, and they remained together as a glorious relationship, really, until the end of both their lives. So I think that what Verdi is doing in Traviata, if you connect Violetta with the figure of Giuseppina Strapponi, is not enforcing social norms and confirming this patriarchal disapproval of the woman who's hired for sex and then discarded. I mean, it's defiantly accusing society of sexual hypocrisy. I mean, that's why Traviata was such a scandal, I mean, a complete fiasco at its first performance, because it was performed in modern dress. I mean, it was only the second production that then switched it back into the 18th century to make it more distant and less offensive. And the fact that it was performed in modern dress, you know, made it really an accusation of the mores, of the people who were sitting in the audience. When you hear the divided strings in the prelude to Traviata, it's these wispy divided strings are telling you about the physiological misery of this woman who is just very ill. She has tuberculosis. That's her problem, not that she's a prostitute. I mean, Verdi's music exists to create sympathy, and he wants to make us cry.
I'm in no doubt that Verdi was sympathetic to his heroine, but some decades on, fellow Italian composer Giacomo Puccini, whose Tosca, Mimi and Butterfly are rarely off today's opera stage, could be charged, if not with misogyny, then certainly with cruelty to his heroines. Puccini, in fact, called himself an executioner and likened himself to the Roman Emperor Nero. David McVicar.
Puccini's heroines die because Puccini needed them to die because he could not compose unless he tortured and killed the heroines. Puccini had no far-reaching dramaturgical philosophy. He was not terribly interested in the operas having a far-reaching message, but he needs to put the heroine on the rack. He needed to be cruel to find that heart-stopping, heart-aching music.
The opera in which Puccini's cruelty is arguably most acute is Madame Butterfly. Mezzo-soprano Christine Rice.
It's the most heartbreaking. Because of the hope that she has at the beginning, the simple heart that she brings to the marriage, and his ignorance that leads him to betray her in the worst way by entering into a full relationship, even fathering a child with her. Not that he knows that when he leaves, but leave he does. Off he goes, without a backward glance. And he always knew that he was going to take an American wife. And she was just too naive and believed in what they had, and absolutely believed it against everybody else telling her that it wasn't. So, I mean, she was a rock. She clung to this. And to then sort of see this fragile temple that she'd built around her love crumble to nothing, to absolute dust by the end of the opera, it's just devastating.
One of Puccini's other great tragic heroines, Tosca, may be considerably more worldly. But she too ultimately falls victim to the cruelty of one man, and just as she has lived for love, dies for it. One soprano who knows Tosca intimately, having both sung the part and directed the opera, is Catherine Malfitano.
There's a naivete and a simplicity about her, and an innocence, frankly, that she believes somehow that Upperson truly couldn't be so evil as to do the things he's doing. I think it's a great betrayal for her to recognize the underbelly of life sometimes is quite cruel and ugly. And maybe that's one of the reasons why she has to die, because her sense of ideals and her sense of what is right and good in life has been absolutely destroyed.
Tosca, Puccini abandons the operatic convention of the swan song with which the tragic heroines traditionally expire from Violetta to Butterfly. The realism that Puccini achieves by dropping this operatic conceit is powerful. Tosca just dies, jumping from a great height.
What I think is so moving about Tosca's jump from the rampart to the castle to her death is the fact that she doesn't actually have an extended aria.
Edward Gardner is music director at English National Opera.
When she realises that Cavaradossi is dead, of course, there's amazingly dramatically heightened music, and it's high in her voice. Mario, su presto. There are sort of screaming trumpets in the orchestra accompanying her. But for me, it's about the delicacy of her parlando, almost spoken lines, as she's watching what she thinks is the act of the fake execution of Cavaradossi. These lines about them being, are they ready yet? And, oh, he's acting so well. And the way Puccini deflects us from the real heightened singing is quite extraordinary. Often in opera, I think the death of men is connected to a sense of morality. And I think you see that from the demise of Don Giovanni. I think you see it in Tosca, actually, with the death of Scarpia. You have a very firm impression as a first listener or first watcher that good is going to triumph over evil. And therefore, Scarpia has to die in the story for the story to make sense, this suppressive male figure of evil. In terms of women, that's never quite the case. It's much more about the free spirit or the entrapment of a woman in the story that leads to her death.
Is death the threshold that has to be crossed for someone like Puccini in order to fulfil, create the climax of a work? It does seem so.
Well,
and it seems so in so many of his operas.
Yes, it is. Death is the Rubicon that has to be crossed, but interestingly, if you look at all of those things, the thing that really tugs at the heartstrings is the reaction of the men to the loss. From La Boheme onwards, it's not the quiet, still moment where Mimi passes away that actually tugs at the heartstrings. It's the scream of Rodolfo. That's the big moment. The same thing in Manon, Lescaut. It's the reaction that is the big moment. And again, in Turandot, it is Timur's reaction to Liu, which is so incredibly moving.
This trope of the woman dying in order to exhibit the man's grief can be traced right back to the origins of opera. Margaret Reynolds.
When opera first came on the scene, the men who devised music and words together looked for stories that would adapt readily into that form. And of course, the key story there, and there were many early operas based on this theme, was the story of Orpheus. Orpheus is a poet, he is a singer, that's fine. But the point of his story is that he sings about a woman who dies. So he sings about his loss of Eurydice. And in fact, that hidden agenda, that the woman has to die so that the man exhibit his pain, is one that actually underlies many operas, although you don't realize it. In Dumas' version of La Dame au Camélia, which is Traviata is based, that's exactly what she died, and her love tells the story. Similarly, in Slender Love of V. Boheme by Merck, upon which Puccini's La Boheme is based, the woman dies so that the man tells the story. The trope which comes through the whole of art and is still, you only have to think of Erigal's love story. The woman has to die so that the man can throw and he has primacy. So it's a very peculiar phenomenon in art. It just has had its a complete apotheosis in art.
In the case of Carmen, yes, Don José gets to exhibit his grief. But really, the overriding impression is that for the gypsy girl Carmen, death is a triumph. At the opera's premiere in Paris in 1875, this death was utterly shocking.
Carmen is the first character who is murdered on stage in full sight of everyone.
Susan McClary.
And
it's a phenomenon in art. Just has had its a complete apotheosis in opera.
In the case of Carmen, yes, Don José gets to exhibit his grief. But really, the overriding impression is that for the gypsy girl Carmen, death is a triumph. At the opera's premiere in Paris in 1875, this death was utterly shocking.
Carmen is the first character who is murdered on stage in full sight of everyone.
Susan McClary.
And it was such a scandal that the people who were the administrators at the Opera Comique actually resigned in protest. He had a lot of trouble finding anyone who would play that part because it was seen as scandalous. He is putting his reputation on the line for the character of Carmen, not of José.
In Bizet's Paris, all artistic conventions were being broken at this time. Invention was in the air. Perhaps this is what made him take such a gamble with Carmen.
He and his collaborators loved going into the red light district, where they would go to brothels. It was in those brothels that they first encountered gypsy music. Men of the late 19th century, these artists, feel that they also are intolerably constricted. And these women become not just stand-ins for loose women, but also ideals and models for the very men who are writing the operas. If Flaubert, the novelist, says, Madame Bovary, c'est moi, I think that Bizet would probably say, Carmen, c'est moi. And that is where the energy of all of these pieces resides.
Mezzo-soprano Christine Rice, who counts Carmen in her repertoire, loves this heroine for her wildness, so unusual for a heroine of the time.
She's such a rare creature in opera, in a way. She owns her own sexuality, for start. She instigates the love affairs. She seeks her fate, and if you like, he's always on the back foot. It's one of the most surprising roles to come out of that period of opera. Often people refer to her sexuality as being male, that she's a rather male character. Well, the people who think that don't know the power of a woman's sexuality, if you like.
now Manon. The heroine of the Abbé Prévost's much earlier novel, written in 1731, she attracts not one, but two major composers of the 19th century.
Does have to die because Manon is far too dangerous. That character can't stay alive. She has to sentimentally die because she stands against rationality. She is all emotion. She makes men behave in crazy ways, as Carmen does. And she has to be punished for this. Society has to win out. For many people, Manon is a girl ready to sell her soul and to destroy her man for wealth and adoration. But soprano Natalie Dessay, who has performed the role in Massenet's version of the story many times, feels compassion for her situation.
That kind of girl at that time had no choice. Either she was going to be married against her will to someone that she didn't love, or she was going to the convent, or she was going to starve. So probably the only choice was to sleep with richer men, to get some money and to have a decent life. Manon has to die because she doesn't behave the way a young girl should behave. She wants to be free, she wants to have luxury, and she wants to get amusement and entertainment. And she knows that she has no other choice than sleeping with rich men to get that. And she admits that she's weak.
Je sais que faiblesse et que fragilité.
And in her aria, she says, je ne suis que faiblesse, for example. Though she knows that she could resist, but actually she can't.
I'm not so fond of these rather weak girls who've never had much of a chance.
Elaine Padmore.
They were always going to die. The whole pathos of the opera is that they die. What's really splendid is the glorious girls, the ones who go out like Isolde and Brunhilde.
Wagner's women, they are rarely victims in the conventional sense, and they die for very different reasons to their Italian or French sisters. Wagner's women die as redemptive actors, like Senta in The Flying Dutchman, Elisabeth in Tannhauser, Brunhilde in The Ring, and don't forget the multifaceted Kundry in Parsifal, who is on stage for the whole of the final act of Wagner's last opera, and expires at the end of it, and who in the course of the whole act only says one thing, dienen, to serve.
Dienen,
She is serving a man, but also a redeemed order, even a redeemed race. I discuss these women and their deaths with David McVicar.
They don't get stabbed, they don't sniff violets. They spontaneously die for redemption. And that's why from Elsa onwards, they sink lifeless to the ground. Isolde's death is a different case because Isolde's death is the erotic culmination of her life. I mean, she still dies because of Wagner's edict that it is the ultimate goal of life, is to die ecstatically, is to be united in death, is to be cosmically united with the object of your love. And love can be most truly expressed away from this world in nullity. We're going to have to open lots of dusty old German philosophy books to really get to the core of this one.
Isolde's death is the most extraordinary one, really. I mean, she literally sings herself to death. She sings herself into a state of ecstasy in which she clearly sees herself reunited with Tristan. It is the most extraordinary and the most glorious piece of it. And how else would you want it to die? You don't want her to go on living. She's not meant to go living. She's meant to have this sort of wonderful transfiguration, which is the most glorious thing. It's the sort of thing that only happens in opera.
Isolde is very much a German heroine shaped by the philosophy of Schopenhauer. But it was in fact in Venice, where Wagner lived for two significant periods in his life, that he discovered another great inspiration for this character. Peter Conrad.
Wagner was absolutely obsessed with a picture by Titian, which he went to see over and over again in the Accademia in Venice. It's a picture of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary, which shows her just sort of floating upwards with her billowing garments towards the vault of heaven, where God is stretched with his arms open, waiting to receive her, looking for all the world like a bat, in fact. And Wagner went to see this again and again, and this is a picture of Isolde. This is what he's describing in the death of Isolde, not the death of the body, but what would you call it? The ascent of the soul, the liberation of the spirit.
Wagner's wife Cosima was convinced that she too, like Isolde, would enter an ecstatic union with her beloved.
The two of them actually set apart a particular sofa in their house in Bayreuth where they were going to sit down and die together in a kind of blissful union at some point in the future. Well, in fact, you know, life doesn't work like it does in opera. Wagner had a heart attack and died instantaneously almost before she could get to him in Venice. And she clung to the body for 24 hours and wouldn't be prized off because she was convinced that since there was no further reason for her to live, somehow she would cease to exist. And she was extremely annoyed that this didn't happen. Wagner thought that there was a kind of animal quality in women, you know, because of their biological function, which he admired because he thought that's what made them close to God. And the wisdom of these women for Wagner is always the fact that they see beyond life. They see that life doesn't matter.
So, where have we got to with all these dying divas? To dismiss 19th century opera as irredeemably misogynist, as Catherine Clément did 30-odd years ago, is rather off the mark. But 19th century opera does mostly deal in male stereotypes of women all the same. It's telling that both La Traviata and Carmen two operas which celebrate transgressive heroines who stand resolutely outside bourgeois convention, met with powerful disapproval when they were premiered. And while Isolde is not really a transgressive figure, it was widely felt, from the first performance onwards, that this was music so intense and so erotic that women should not be exposed to it. Individual composers may have challenged convention, but you can't get away from the fact that 19th century opera reflects a 19th century society anxious to keep women in their place. For operatic heroines, these were pretty dangerous times. But with the great social upheavals at the dawn of the modern era, things began to change for women, both off and on stage, as reflected in works by Leos Janacek and Richard Strauss. Elaine Padmore.
Gradually, you can see the plots developing into ones that truly have some social bite. You come before very long to Janacek's operas. When we get to Yennefer, we're definitely into a much more outspoken social itinerary, and there you can very plainly see that Yennefer actually does have a happy ending despite everything that's gone on. Yennefer has suffered, Yennefer has gone through, but she is triumphant at the end and she is going on to a new life. This is the move away from these kind of girls who died, from girls who will see their way through into a triumphant future. And of course, as soon as we get into the 20th century, you're getting truly into operas with a social message. I mean, look at Richard Strauss's operas. Once he's got over his monstrous women like Salome and Elektra, these kind of mythical post-Wagnerian monstrous women, he's then onto a whole gallery of wonderful women, not one of whom dies.
It is, though, Alban Berg who, at least for me, finally draws the curtain down on the operatic era of dead women. He does this in a work which confronts the death of its central character head-on, no flinching, no sentimentality. Lulu is murdered by Jack the Ripper. Her death has none of Violetta's noble suffering. Her final words are "no, no," followed by a scream. As she dies, Berg unleashes a massive orchestral discord of immense violence. Lulu is unmistakably a victim. There is not a drop of consolation in the music that follows her death. No neat ending, no tidy moral, no rounded conclusion, just awareness. Not before time, I think.
Why Do Women Die in Opera was presented by Martin Kettle and produced by Hannah Rosenfelder. It was a Just Radio production for BBC Radio 3.